Warm welcome to all of you to IIT Bombay, and thanks to Professor Phatak for his very, very inspiring speech. And see, we have been teaching this course, myself and my colleague Professor Inamdar, for over 4 years now, and it has been very enjoyable. And as Professor Phatak mentioned, that what is basic necessity is that to interact with students more. That is one of the things that we keep doing on a regular basis. As far as engineering mechanics is concerned, we see that the rules are very simple. As such, it's a very simple course. And when the students actually come through JEE, they already have some experience. You know, they already have their learning a skill on mechanics. So that is, having said that, it is not true probably all colleges and universities. So our students tend to perform better, and as a first year student, they are always sincere. That we have to keep in mind. As I said, what we'll do over the period of time is that in these 5 days, basically we are going to spend very little time on the lecture. So it will be, let's say, half an hour to 45 minutes lecture, and that will be displayed on slides, because as I said, all of us are teaching and we know what are the nitty-gritty details, but we'll just try to emphasize where students get stuck. So that is what we are going to do more, that this is what we feel in IIT, that students are having difficulties at this part of the lecture and this particular topic. So we are going to kind of focus on that. And then what happens, that we are going to have, again, as Professor Phatak also mentioned, that we are going to spend time ourselves to solve some tutorial problems. So as such, these problems are also given in IIT to our students. And then we have to also solve the quizzes. So quizzes will be, let's say, 5 minutes or 10 minutes quizzes. That is what we are going to do, and we just flash it on the slide, and we have to answer those problems in 5 minutes time. That's all. Now, I just want to know one thing, that all of you, do you actually, all of you have direct experience teaching engineering mechanics? All of you, how many of you have taught directly engineering mechanics? Please raise your hand. Just want to get a feeling. And how many of you have taught, let's say, structural analysis or, let's say, solid mechanics type of course, little bit advanced level? Okay, so great. So we have a large number who have taught engineering mechanics. Now I will just quickly talk about the syllabus that is being proposed, and this is what we tend to follow in IIT. And predominantly we deal with statics problem with some focus on the structural dynamics towards the very end, and the reason being that we mostly try to have our emphasis on the force balance and moment balance. So we teach the entire course as if a student has a feeling that he is looking at simply a force balance and moment balance, and we can do that even for structural dynamics problems. So that is what we tend to do. Okay, so we can discuss it out later on, how to modify this and so on and so forth. So we have a discussion session towards the, I think it will be held on Friday. So we'll talk about that a bit more. So with that, I think what we'll do quickly, we'll start the lecture. That is, first lecture will be on the introductory part of mechanics, and we are mostly going to look at the fundamental concepts that the student already have. And we assume that students should have sufficient knowledge on this type of, these concepts. So that is what we are going to start off with. And if we go to Wikipedia, so what is mechanics in general? All of you know, students are these days very advanced, so they actually look at a lot of internet, and you can see there are large number of NPTEL courses.
There are some online courses. If you go to visit some US universities, we see a large number of, you know, open learning initiatives are there. So therefore, students are very, very familiar with internet options and all that thing that we have. So as such, mechanics, it is pronounced as mechanics. And basically what it is, it's a branch of physical science that deals with the forces and energy. That is as per the definition of, you know, Wikipedia. Now the practical application of mechanics to design, construction, operation of machines or tools. Now what is nice is actually the third part of it, mechanical or functional details or procedure. That is, you know, they have just given mechanics of brain. So the word mechanics has been used to also describe the procedure. So, you know, our take is here could be also mechanics of teaching. What is the mechanics of teaching? Okay, how do I answer to the students to their satisfaction? That is what I think most intriguing for us as such. Okay, so now as we know that mechanics is the science which describes and predicts the condition of rest or motion of bodies under the action of forces. And we know that mechanics is going to be required for advanced studies, such as we see the solid mechanics, that is very fundamentally important. Then we are going to see structural design analysis and machine design and so on and so forth. Okay. What are the branches of mechanics? We have statics and dynamics. These are the two typical branches, where statics is mostly going to deal with forces that is under rest. That means all the variables are time independent, whereas in dynamics, all the variables are time dependent. So these are the broad ways to think about mechanics, two disciplines of mechanics, statics and dynamics. Remember, so why do we need an elaborate course on mechanics? And as I said, the rules are very, very simple. And we give a flavor to the students that, okay, look, this is simply going to be force balance and moment balance. However, things are very complex because most of the mechanics problems deals with interaction, multi-body interaction, that is interaction of forces. Okay, so therefore, we need to really tell students that how we typically solve the problems by taking into account the multi-body interaction. So this is what we have to, you know, ensure that we give them a good understanding on how to deal with the complex problems. Remember, one of the important aspects would be concepts of appropriate free body diagram. So whenever we are solving, we have to make sure we tell them that the free body diagram is the most important thing that they should do, okay? And the type of books we follow, we basically follow three books. First one is Beer and Johnston. Second one is by James. And the third one is by Merriam and Craig. So these are the three books that is followed, that are followed in IIT. And we have to acknowledge these books because what happens is that we also have taken many problems. In fact, some of the lecture slides are directly taken from, you know, these authors. So we have to acknowledge those. And some of the useful links that we give it to our students is howstuffworks.com, very important link. There actually you can see, you know, all the animations are there, how things are moving, how things are behaving. Lot of practical problems are there that gives an instant feedback, visual feedback, that what is happening with this problem. So this is a very important website. The other website is, it is actually an open learning initiative by Carnegie Mellon University in US. So they have a very nice website where, you know, both teachers and students can actually enter. So they have to register, and you can see large number of, you know, problems are there. So we have taken also some help from this particular website. So the first thing that I will be doing very quickly is that going through some of the fundamentals. As I said, that all of us have to ensure that students are actually, these are kind of prerequisite for this course, so we make sure that students know already aware of what are dimensions, what are vectors and scalars. They are familiar with parallelogram law, Newton's law, principle of transmissibility, and system of units. So these are the six things that we expect that students have a good grasp of it. Now, as far as dimensions are concerned, we all know that there are three independent dimensions that is related to space, time, and mass. These are three independent quantities that we have. These are actually absolute concepts. And we have also force. Now, force is not an absolute concept. Rather, these are related to mass and time, right? Okay, so they are actually dependent on the other three dimensions that we have, okay? So vectors and scalars, so we know that vectors should possess both magnitude and the direction, and as well as vectors should be added according to the parallelogram law, okay? So ultimately, if we look at P and Q, two vectors, then the diagonal that it forms, right? So that will be the diagonal of the parallelogram. Similarly, scalar, so scalar has only magnitude, no direction. Then we come to the Newton's law. We have Newton's first law. So in Newton's first law, we state that every particle continues in a state of rest or uniform motion in a straight line unless it is compelled to change that state by forces imposed on it. Okay, and the second law is basically force is proportional to acceleration. So we have that proportionality constant, which is mass. So this first law actually brings in the essence of statics. So we can also restate as that if the resultant force on a body is zero, then the body should be at rest or it will be under uniform motion. Okay. And the second law brings in the concept of inertia, right? So we state that there is an inertia force that is mass times acceleration. Now when we look at also in a in structural dynamics type of problem, that inertia force, we say that this is going to actually oppose the motion. In fact, we can treat the dynamic problem as a static problem by simply in the free body diagram, we can say that the force is taken in an opposite sense to that of a motion, and we can handle the problem in a static way. Then Newton's third law, every action has equal and opposite reactions. And finally, we have Newton's law of gravitation that is coming into play. And through that, we actually know that there is a gravitational constant, right? So now next comes to the principle of transmissibility. So that is another important concept that we have. So what it is that conditions of equilibrium or motion will not be affected by transmitting a force along its line of action, right? So that means if I have a body and I have force F, I can actually transmit it anywhere along its line. So force as such has an infinite line of action, okay? And there is a very nice example here. So just to demonstrate that, let's say we talk about this truck in a simplified manner. It does not matter whether I apply the force in this way in the front of the truck, or rather I pull the truck from the front, or I push it from the back. That means my line of action remains same, and force can be transmitted anywhere in the line of action. Now, once we tell that, then what comes into play? As long as equilibrium is concerned, it is absolutely fine. But when we are actually interested in the deformation of the body, which we tend to do in mechanics of solids, let's say, then can we apply that rule? The answer is no. So what it is that if I take a pen and if I really pull it at the two ends of it, what is my total deformation? The internal deformation that is taking place will not be equal if I just put this force in the middle and try to pull it. The two deformation will be absolutely different. And that is what we have to, you know, keep in mind. We have to tell students, look, you can do this absolutely fine as long as you are simply interested in the equilibrium. But when it comes to the internal deformation, that is not allowed. So the units, very important, you know, we tend to emphasize again, there are two system of units. One is the SI unit, another is the US units. So here we represent it by kg, mass, and second. And here it is going to be slug, foot, and second. Okay, now why we tell this repeatedly to the students that try to be very consistent with the conversion between one unit to the other unit if it is required in the problem. However, in general, we give the problems in SI units, but you look at any authors in US, actually they will have the books in FPS units. So therefore, in some cases, we may have to convert this FPS unit to the SI units. And remember, this was a very interesting fact that happened. This NASA Mars Climate Orbiter, this was the first weather satellite. Now, two teams were working, actually. One was using SI unit, another one was using FPS units. What happened that when the, you know, satellite was launched, it actually crashed. Because one team forgot to actually convert the FPS unit back to the SI units. So we again try to kind of emphasize these effects that how important these are when it comes to solving the problem. So what is the idealization of mechanics? That is most important that we all know that we are actually going to look at rigid bodies. So we assume it as a rigid body. Why is that? So for example, first of all, assume that this is a beam on a support. I apply a force. Now what I do, I only consider that there is a pure translation and pure rotation to the body. That is only possibility. Now we do not actually consider the actual deformation that can take place, or we rather assume that the deformed geometry and original geometry, they remain same as long as we try to solve for the forces through the equilibrium. So here my intention would be to really solve for the support reactions, let's say. So it is not necessary that we have to calculate in each step how this force is actually changing its direction as the body from its original geometry assumes the deformed geometry. That is going to create very big problem for us. As such, in nonlinear mechanics, that is done in practice. Okay, but here we assume the deformation is very small. Therefore, the body preserves the original geometry and we make a rigid body assumption. So how do I solve the problems? So first of all, a problem will be given with a data, with the proper geometry, and a figure that shows all the quantities. We are really going to tell that this part is the most important part. That is, as soon as I have the problem in hand, we should draw a free body diagram, which will clearly show all the forces, both known forces and the unknown forces. That has to be done at the very beginning. And next would be just to apply the fundamental principles. That means we are going to, you know, use the equations of equilibrium or equations of motion to get the forces. Solution check. One of the important point that I discussed is that units. Students can easily look at, am I getting the correct units back or not? That is the first thing. Second thing is that every problem should have a logic. And what we feel that students should be able to examine the answer, whether they got it correctly or not, through the intuition. So they have to really examine the answers with the intuition. It is not that they have to make sure that, okay, my final number is correct, let's say, but the direction. Direction is very, very important. Am I getting the direction correctly? Am I getting the position of the, let's say, resultant force correctly, and so on and so forth. So logical conclusion has to be there for each and every problem. Okay, and therefore, this is most important thing that can only be learned by solving a large amount of problems. Different types of problem we have to solve to get this experience and skill as the as we go through, these topics. So again, I'll just quickly go through different types of problems that we will see actually in this course. And remember why we are doing engineering mechanics. As I said, that it is basically modeling of real life problems. So there are many, we are really trying to make a backbone, model of the actual problem. So we are trying to simplify that model. Therefore, what is most important is that to get the, supports, connections, those things very accurately in the free body diagram. So in that way, you can also think of, in a reverse way, we can tell students that, okay, I have a problem, I really want to create a very simplified model of that. That will give me the solution of the problem in a reasonable manner. It can be other way around. Engineering mechanics can help them to design actual an experiment. For example, what is a roller? Let's say, what is a hinge? How do I make those in the lab? So these are also important aspects. So they are actually kind of contemporary to each other. Solving a real life problem and going from engineering mechanics to the demonstration in a laboratory environment. So for example, we can quickly show here, this is just a handy crane. Can I actually solve the force in this hydraulic cylinder? First of all, why this hydraulic cylinder is here? And second, how do I go about solving this problem? Okay. Similarly, we can look at a drawbridge. You see a lot of places in Europe actually, they have this kind of drawbridge. What it does actually help in maneuvering the boats or small ships once they come, once they passes through these small channels or river. So ultimately, see again, this is a bare backbone model, very simplified model of this drawbridge. Ultimately, we are going to apply a force, and therefore, through this force, depending on the amount of this force, we are going to get an equilibrium configuration back. So, for example, can I get the force in this cable, in this model? Again, right? Or how much force is required, for example, to hold this body in equilibrium configuration, given equilibrium configuration? Okay. So like that, we can see that this is another problem. These are some of the real life examples. That's a ladder climbing. How do I approximate this problem? Okay. So again, supports and connections plays an important role, and how we are going to take the effect of the forces on the body, that is what we tend to demonstrate to the students. When it comes to robotics, this is a very nice problem. Students are given to come up with a model of an arm. It's a robotic arm. So what it is, actually, there is a competition that kill as many good guys as you can. Okay, so there is an eliminator who is actually going to kill as many good guys as he can. So ultimately, I have to design this robotic arm to hold the good guys in the neck. As long as I can lift them up, it's fine. Competition is over. So ultimately, what is happening, the force that is required, that is really, this is called the pincer force. So that force that I am going to apply depends on the friction force that is coming at the interface. So students can actually, you know, think of this way that, okay, these are the type of problems I am going to solve in this course. Remember, this is a very nice website because there are a lot of robotic competition. Even IIT also have, you know, one good competition that is tech-faced. You know, robotics competitions comes into play. Some of the, you know, aerospace side, we can just say, okay, what is the aerodynamic lift force that we have in this wing spar? How do I actually approximate that aerodynamic force? So ultimately, again, this is a very simplified demonstration to tell that, okay, as long as I know what kind of supports are there in the wing, which is connecting the body with the wing, then if we know the loading pattern on it, can I actually solve for the support reactions? Similarly, how to model a bridge problem? Let's say we have, you know, these are actually supports, so we take these supports right here, then we can also have the connections. These connections are also modeled here, and we have the uniformly distributed load that is placed on the beam. Some other examples are on the vibration side, and probably car is a very good example on when it comes to the vibration. Basically, what the intention here to tell that, okay, we have the, you know, suspension system. That suspension system can really be modeled as a mass, spring, and damper. And from there, if we really look at those problems, that is what we are going to learn in this course. So the mass, spring, damper system, can we derive the equation of motion? Can I get the natural frequency? If there is a forced vibration, can I get the displacement, velocity, acceleration, and so on, so forth? Okay. So the idea is that give a large number of problems just at the very beginning of the introduction to give them a flavor is what we are actually going to see in this course. Important thing, numerical accuracy. See, numerical accuracy of a solution will depend on two things. One is the accuracy of the data given, and another one is the accuracy of the computations performed. See, the solution, the actual solution cannot be more accurate than less accurate of this. I am given with the data. Now, data is usually given in the book. I don't know how it is transferred from the field to the, let's say, book, but some random number is given. Let's say data is correct. Okay, then the choice is whether we have the, you know, computations performed correctly. But in these days, we use the calculators, you know, with a large number of decimal places. So as such, computations are not going to, you know, give any truncation error. So whatever error that we see in an engineering problem is coming from the data, actually. How we, you know, data is taken to the real life problem. So we see that we tell that the, you know, appropriately we just record the parameters beginning with one with four digits and with three digits in all other cases. So these examples are given here. So just to avoid the truncation error, we have to take into account certain number of decimal places when we are solving the problem.